Quest presents an unabridged recording of Murder Sky High by Linda Hagan, narrated by Jennifer Fitzgerald. Chapter 1. The note of the twin turbofan engines changed as the plane began its gentle descent into Belfast City Airport. Some of the passengers, first-timers in Northern Ireland, looked out of their windows with varying degrees of interest and excitement as the aircraft followed the line of Belfast Lock, snaking its way to the sea. They watched the tapestry of green fields set out below them, the islands peeping out of the distant waters of Strangford Lock, County Down, looking its best in the weak February sun, before quickly giving way to the urban sprawl of Belfast. Others, the seasoned business travellers, began gathering their belongings together, aware that they would soon be arriving at George Best Airport and wanting to make a quick escape. In row 24, seat A, there was no movement. The passenger lay back, eyes closed, legs stretched out before him. The middle-aged man, grey of suit and grey of face, had been silent throughout the flight. His nearest neighbour, a lanky 20-something in jeans and sweatshirt, with a beanie hat covering his fair hair, had had his back turned to him for most of the flight. He was busy talking to his girlfriend across the aisle. The two had eyes only for each other. As the seatbelt warning sign pinged, and the cabin staff began to gather up rubbish into black plastic bags and ensure overhead lockers were tightly closed for landing, he stood up and knocked against his slumbering neighbour.
"Sorry, mate."
The man didn't respond. He couldn't. He was dead. Chapter 2. Chief Inspector Gawn Girvin slowly opened her eyes and took a moment to register where she was. This morning it was her own bed. Since she had got together with Sebastian York, they had played what he had dubbed bed ping-pong. Unable to decide where and how they would live together, they both still asserted that they wanted to. He was keen that she move in with him. His house was bigger with a spare bedroom he could keep as his study, where he did his writing. Her two-bed apartment would never be able to cope with his collection of books. And anyway, he argued, Ballyhackamore was a livelier spot, only a short glider ride from the city centre, or a quick car journey to his work at the university or police headquarters. She didn't want to tell him that living there would remind her too much of how they had met and her ordeal with the serial killer. Instead, she made excuses to him, but sometimes she wondered if she was really making excuses to herself. After all, if his home reminded her of those experiences, her apartment should do so even more. Instead of making any decision, she kept her apartment in the lockside town of Carrickfergus under the looming grey presence of the medieval castle, and he stayed on in Belfast. It was satisfactory, most of the time, but sometimes Gawn wondered if their inability to decide on a home together signalled a deeper issue about commitment and about the prospects for their long-term relationship. She looked across at this man, who had come so quickly to mean so much to her. A strand of his hair had fallen over his eye, and his mouth was slightly open. He looked like a toddler exhausted after a day of mayhem at the nursery, and sometimes she felt that was like his life. She loved him. No one could have been more surprised than she was to realise that very soon after they had first met. But he was unpredictable. She sometimes felt like a responsible adult trying to keep an errant child in line. Her job demanded she be serious and steady, not capricious and impulsive. Sometimes his surprises were wonderful, like the romantic trip to New York he had arranged for them just before Christmas, but he didn't seem to really understand her commitment to her work and its demands. They had had their first serious argument when she had forgotten to call and let him know she was busy and would not be able to get to dinner at his house after he had spent all afternoon creating a very special meal for them. She had been apologetic the next morning
when she remembered to phone him after working 18 hours straight. She thought she'd done well taking the time to ring rather than simply collapsing into bed exhausted, but he didn't seem to appreciate that and only responded like a petulant teenager. Of course, she didn't realize he had intended to ask her to marry him that night and had had the ring ready to produce. She still didn't know. She glanced at her watch and slipped out of bed, not wanting to wake him. She had barely made it across the room when her mobile started ringing, and she darted back to snatch it off the bedside table.
"Sorry to bother you at home, ma'am, on your day off."
It was the voice of her new sergeant, Michael Harris.
"What is it?"
Her voice was serious, unwelcoming. She didn't want to encourage him to think he could phone her at home all the time. He needed to show initiative.
"There's been a body found on a plane at City Airport. The super wants us to take over from uniform."
She didn't hesitate. It was not that she was jumping to an order from her superior. Rather, she was excited to be involved in a new case. That flutter of not knowing what lay ahead, the thrill of the chase, was her drug of choice nowadays.
"I'll be in the office in..."
She glanced down at her watch and made a quick calculation.
"Give me an hour. Be ready to leave with me."
"Yes, ma'am." She practically ran into the shower. An hour was going to be an ask. No time to waste.
"Gawn,"
Seb's sleepy voice sounded plaintively from the bedroom.
"Go back to sleep. I've had a call out. I'll see you later."
He would have to be content with that. No time to go into explanations or discussions or for another row. They seemed to be arguing more frequently lately, but she couldn't take time to think about that now. He didn't respond, and she could imagine what he had been planning for their day together and how disappointed he would be. But for her, duty would always come first. He needed to get used to that, or this relationship just wasn't going anywhere. Chapter 3. The officers on the serious crime squad team that Gawn led were surprised to see her when she appeared at the door. That much was obvious. Harris hadn't told them she was coming. Billy Logan, a veteran detective who was heading towards retirement, was lounging over his computer screen and hastily shut the page when she approached, but not before she had seen what he was looking at, the latest football news. Jamie Grant, the baby of the squad, was sitting with his feet up on the desk and almost fell off his seat in his haste to get them down onto the floor. Gawn was not impressed if this was how her new sergeant, Michael Harris, ran things while she was away.
"Okay, you lot, listen up."
Harris barked out the words as he entered the room behind her. Suddenly realizing she was there, he hastily came to a halt and, looking extremely flustered, managed to say,
Sorry, ma'am. I wasn't expecting you so soon."
"That much is obvious, Sergeant."
She had made better time than she had expected. The traffic hadn't been too heavy, and she was ahead of schedule. His face flushed an even brighter red. He had been so delighted to be given the opportunity to work with serious crimes and become a real detective, as he had told his friends. He had waited for quite a long time since passing his sergeant's exams, but he felt it was worth waiting for. Her team, and especially the chief inspector herself, had quite a reputation in the PSNI. He knew she wasn't popular with all her colleagues, but that didn't seem to worry her. Now, for her to find some of her team, and there was no other word for it, seemingly skiving off under his command, was devastating for the young man.
"I take it not a lot has been happening."
She raised her eyebrow in query as her look swept the room. Everyone else's head was down. They were hunched over their desks, clearly trying not to catch her eye. Harris had no such luxury. The question had been directed to him.
"Well, ma'am, not too much, not until now. We were just ticking over, finishing off odds and ends.
Jack's away giving evidence in the Bingham case today, and Aaron's working with the tech boys to see if we can retrieve Montgomery's emails. Everybody else has just been finishing up work, but we've just had that call now about the body at City Airport. The coroner's requested an investigation, and the super wants us for it.
His words came out in a rush, an indication of his nervousness around his new boss.
That'll make us popular with someone.
She didn't really care if she was popular or not. She never did. A case was a case. The more challenging, the better.
Right, Sergeant. You and I had better head down to the airport to see what's what.
She raised her voice enough to be heard throughout the room.
The rest of you, get your finishing off finished. You'll be busy soon enough.
Two police cars parked in a chevron formation blocked entry to the dual carriageway at the beginning of the Sydenham bypass, and two bored-looking officers were directing traffic, sending cars round onto other roads. As Gawn drove slowly up to one of the officers, she could see him preparing himself to respond to yet another silly woman asking what was wrong or demanding to be let through to get to her flight. He moved closer, signalling to her to wind the window down.
Sorry, I'm afraid you can't use the bypass this morning, madam. You'll have to take the new Tynards Road instead.
Gawn lowered her car window a little further and held up her warrant card without speaking. She didn't need to. His response was immediate.
Sorry, ma'am.
He quickly turned away and signalled for one of the police cars to be moved so she could drive through. She waved in thanks to the officer manoeuvring her car out of her way. Harris hadn't travelled with his new boss before. One thing he had found a little disconcerting about their journey was that she didn't seem to go in for very much casual conversation. It seemed she wasn't one for small talk. He wondered if she was still annoyed at finding the office not exactly a hive of activity and angry with him for not cracking the whip and getting the others working flat out. She pulled her car into the taxi waiting area, directly in front of the main doors. Another uniformed officer, submachine gun slung across his body, was just about to tell them to move on when Gawn got out of the car and it was obvious that he recognised her. He merely nodded his head in acknowledgement and moved back to where he had been standing guard. She walked through the automatic doors with Harris following closely behind her. Inside was thronged with travellers, most of them with luggage. This would normally be a busy time of day. First flights in and out of the airport, the business travellers clutching briefcases and newspapers, heading into the city for meetings, the little family groups and couples excitedly waiting for their early holidays to begin. Those who had been lucky enough to arrive before the discovery of the body would be safely away, perhaps even unaware that anything had happened. But those wanting to get away were now sitting disgruntled waiting for news. There would be all kinds of rumours circulating, and the sight of uniformed police officers would add to the speculation. It was obvious the discovery of the body had caused major headaches for the airport staff. The two help desks had long queues, the check-in desks were unmanned. Overhead, signs indicated indefinite delays to every flight leaving, although one flight from Tenerife had just landed. Prospective passengers with their luggage gathered all around them were filling what few seats there were. A large group of excited primary school pupils, identified by their school-logoed sweatshirts, accompanied by a trio of stressed-looking teachers, was sitting on the floor right in the centre of the concourse. Other hopeful travellers were perched uncomfortably on top of their suitcases or standing around them in huddles like groups at a campfire. The little cafe area, never designed to deal with such numbers, was packed, and two harassed baristas were working hard to keep up with demand. There was a buzz of noise, and some angry voices raised in complaint. Gawn caught the eye of someone she knew on the far side of the concourse and strode across to him.
I wondered who they would send to take over.
Good morning, Paul.
Gann smiled in greeting. She knew Inspector Paul Maxwell only too well. He had been her sergeant until just a few months ago, but had moved to the local station and back into uniform when he had got his promotion. Their paths had not crossed again professionally until today.
"Good morning, Chief Inspector."
He smiled too. He wasn't exactly glad that someone was taking over, but if it had to happen, then he was glad it was Gann.
"Paul, this is Michael Harris, my new sergeant."
Her eyes twinkled as she continued.
"And this is Inspector Paul Maxwell, my former sergeant."
The two men shook hands, sizing each other up. Harris was a few inches shorter than Maxwell, but he had a rugby-forwards build, short and stocky with wide shoulders. His bulging biceps filled the arms of his suit jacket. Maxwell's slim build and open friendly face were a contrast, and he couldn't help wondering how this new man would get on with Gann, and more interestingly, how she would get on with him.
"We'll have to get together and compare notes sometime, Sergeant," Maxwell suggested. "Like hell you will. Now, Inspector, bring us up to speed." "Right, ma'am. The 9 a.m. KLM arrival from Amsterdam landed on time, and when the passengers started to disembark, the cabin crew found what they initially thought was an unconscious passenger. They assumed he had simply taken ill, but then they quickly realized they had a corpse on their hands and no indication of how he'd died. They immediately notified the control tower and kept the rest of the passengers on board until they could verify what had happened."
Succinct. She had taught him well.
"So all the passengers are still on board?" "No, they were getting a bit obstreperous by the time I got here, and forensics and the pathologists needed space to work, so we disembarked them and they're being held in a separate area. My men have started interviewing them and checking their details."
"Okay, good work, Paul. Who was our corpse then? I presume identification would have been straightforward between the passenger list and his passport," Gann asked.
"His name's Willem de Beck. He's a Dutch businessman. He was booked on a return flight this evening to Heathrow. He had his ticket in his pocket, so he was obviously over for just a short visit, a business meeting most likely, but there's no indication where or with whom."
"Can we take a look at the scene?"
"Of course, boss."
The words were out of his mouth without thinking.
"Old habits die hard, eh, Paul?"
"Sorry, ma'am." He was embarrassed to have reverted to the role of Gann's sidekick in front of Harris. He led them through security, with the civilian searchers and baggage handlers standing around, hands in pockets, looking unsure what they should be doing. The three were aware that they were being watched as they walked past. Rather than taking the passenger route to the plane, Maxwell led them through a set of doors marked Airport Personnel Only. This was obviously a working area, no oversized tourist posters and trendy decor here, just scuffed plain white walls and utilitarian flooring to take the heavy baggage traffic of a busy airport. After a short walk down a corridor, they found themselves heading outside. The plane was on its stand. The three climbed the steps, Maxwell leading the way. Gann immediately got a claustrophobic feeling from the inside of the plane. It was smaller than she liked to travel in, preferring something more the size of a transatlantic Airbus. Here, two seats either side of a narrow aisle left her feeling hemmed in. Two burly SOCOs filled the back of the plane, meaning the three officers could only reach part of the way to the corpse. Another white-suited figure was leaning over the body, blocking out their view. When it turned, Gann saw a face she didn't recognize. Maxwell whispered to her,
"The new locum pathologist, Dr. Jennifer Norris. Monroe's on a sabbatical and she's the duty pathologist today."
Al Monroe was the chief state pathologist and their paths had crossed a few times.
"Good morning there, folks. How y'all doing?"
Norris' cheery welcome sounded out of place. Dr. Norris was, Gann judged, about mid-40s, although well-preserved for her age.
A wisp of blonde hair had escaped from her coverall, and she hastily pushed it back. She was slightly built, with a thin waistline, a tanned complexion from what Gan could see of her face, and those big baby blue eyes so beloved of men of a certain age. Her voice had a faint American twang.
"Good morning, Doctor. I'm DCI Gawn Girvin, and this is my sergeant. Do we have something to investigate here, or is this just natural causes?"
"It's a sudden unexplained death, Chief Inspector, and I need to have a closer look before I can go certifying the cause. I don't know this guy's medical history, so he could have had high blood pressure or a heart condition. Any number of things could have caused his death. From what I can see here, there's no obvious trauma, no wounds, no bleeding, but I'm a little suspicious of a slight split, I guess you'd call it, on the arm of his jacket, which could have been caused by a needle or a stiletto or some other very fine object. Maybe he just caught his jacket on something, but it doesn't look exactly like a tear. Until I get him back onto my table and out of his clothes where I can examine him properly, I don't know what caused it."
"You think someone stabbed him?"
Harris's voice was skeptical. He didn't see the smartly dressed, middle-aged man slumped in the aircraft seat as a typical target for a murder, especially a dramatic murder on a plane. It reminded him of something Agatha Christie might have written.
"I'm not suggesting anything. That's your job, not mine. But there's no blood externally on the clothes, so probably not."
"But you're not prepared to call this natural causes?" Gan asked.
"No, I can. Not yet. I need to take a closer look and run tox screens."
Gan thought the new doctor might simply be being overcautious, not wanting to miss something. But her thoroughness and her willingness to pursue answers to her concerns was something Gan could relate to. Better to take the time and get it right. "If I can get his medical details and it turns out he had an ongoing serious health condition that he was being treated for, and I can examine any marks on the body and rule them out, then I'll certify natural causes. Otherwise, you just need to let me do my job."
"Of course, Doctor. We'll get details from all the other passengers, and we'll join you at the PM to see if we need to follow up."
"Fine. My schedule's clear tomorrow. So far, anyway," she added. "I'll talk to his doctor if I can, and if not, or he didn't have any health issues, then I'll do the autopsy tomorrow afternoon. But the tox screens will take a few days. Is 3 p.m. okay for you?"
"Yes."
Gan noted the doctor's use of the American term autopsy and wondered what other different attitudes and approaches she might bring to her work. Monroe was a good pathologist, careful and meticulous in every detail, but sometimes infuriatingly slow and pedantic. Gan swung round, surprising her sergeant, who was standing tightly behind her in the narrow aisle. He seemed to be unsure whether he should turn and walk out in front of her or step aside into a seat and let her pass. He did the latter. When they reached the fresh air again, and Harris had gone to get a passenger list from the airline desk, Maxwell turned to his former boss.
"You have him terrified?"
Her face furrowed.
"Do I?"
"You know you do. The same way you had me at first. Give him a break, Gan. He'll be doing his best, you know. It's not easy getting up to speed, especially your speed." He smiled. That little boy smile he had tried to employ with her in the past. Sometimes successfully, mostly not. Maxwell's advice drew a smile onto Gan's face. Before they could say anything more, the sergeant was back.
"Have we got a seating plan?"
Gan directed this question to both men.
"Yes, my men put one together. Here."
Maxwell produced an A4 sheet of paper from the leather folder he had been carrying. Gan smiled at the sight of it. She had bought him the folder on his promotion to inspector and had it engraved with his initials. The paper he was holding out to her was a photocopy of a seating plan with the names of the passengers neatly marked beside each seat in pencil.
"Here's where the back was sitting."
He indicated a window seat near the back of the plane.
The passenger next to him was David Smith. Then in the two seats behind them were Paul Vanhoven and William Andrews. Lots of individual travellers on the flight. It's too early for much holiday traffic, so they're mostly businessmen. Except Smith. He and his girlfriend, she was sitting here. Maxwell indicated a seat across the aisle. They're here on holiday.
Nobody in the two seats in front of him?
No, the flight wasn't full today.
As Maxwell finished speaking, a voice from behind chirped in.
Excuse me, folks. Dr. Norris passed between them, carrying her heavy leather bag. See you at 3 tomorrow, Chief Inspector.
She smiled a friendly smile at them as she passed. She took half a dozen steps, then paused, and the three watched as the white-garbed doctor released her hair from the hood of the forensic suit and shook her head to free it. Then she walked briskly across the tarmac to the main building, where she disappeared from their view. Gawn had the distinct impression the new woman had known she was being watched and had enjoyed it.
Have you come across her before, Paul?
Yes, I have. Just last week, actually. Monroe brought her to the station to introduce her. They were doing some kind of tour, some sort of induction program they've developed to improve communication between us and them.
He held up his hands and mimicked speech marks, smirking at the idea of communicating with the pathologists.
What did you think of her?
Gawn was trying to form her own first impressions of their new colleague. There had been quite a few changes recently, and she was trying to come to terms with them all.
She seemed fine. She seems a bit more approachable than the others, I think. Bit more normal, and friendly enough.
Where'd she come from?
Ah, now that's interesting.
Maxwell's voice became more animated.
She was with the medical examiner's office in Boston.
Gawn was pleased that her ear had picked up the flat Bostonian vowels.
But her accent's mostly from here.
Yes, originally. She's a bit like yourself. She was in London for a couple of years, and then the US, but she's from Northern Ireland.
Gawn always liked to know who she was working with. It might seem that she didn't know much about her colleagues. She didn't spend time chatting with them about their families, for instance. But in fact, she knew a lot. She knew that her new sergeant still lived at home with his parents and that his mother had MS. She thought the fact that he wasn't married and didn't have the responsibility of children would mean he could commit more time to his work without problems. Kerry, Maxwell's wife, had always nagged him about the time commitment Gawn expected of him.
Right, let's go and speak to these people and get them on their way. We don't want to waste any more of their time.
Her voice made it clear she felt she was wasting her time here. Chapter 4. They walked back into the building and made their way to the room where the passengers had been sequestered. There were about 20 people still there. Some were sitting in bored-looking or agitated clumps around the wall. A few were seated at tables facing police constables. As each conversation finished, the passengers were escorted out of the room to collect their luggage. Maxwell pointed to the three men and a young woman seated along the wall in the far corner of the room. Two of the men were older. One was sitting looking over papers, as if he couldn't take time away from his work. The other sat looking around the room, watching what was going on, his eyes darting from group to group. She thought he looked a little furtive, but then decided that was probably only her imagination. While Gawn watched, his hand went to his coat pocket and brought out a small white paper bag. After careful examination of its contents, he extracted something and popped it into his mouth. She noticed he didn't offer to share with anyone. The two others who had been separated out were both in their early 20s. The man was tall and slim. Even though he was sitting down, the length of his legs in his skin-tight jeans showed he would be well over 6 feet tall. His companion was short, not just in comparison. Gawn reckoned she wouldn't be much over 5 feet tall. Her feet barely touched the floor from her sitting position. She could pass for a schoolgirl, Gawn thought.
Her slim waist and heavy bosom reminded her of a character from the carry-on films that her father had loved so much. She had always found it strange that such a straight-laced, almost puritanical man could revel in such ribald comedy.
That's the three men who were closest to the back, and one girlfriend who wouldn't be separated.
Okay, we'll have a word with them then. Maxwell held back while Gan walked across the room, aware of eyes watching her. She could read degrees of annoyance and unease among the people still waiting to be interviewed.
Shall we make it ladies first? She asked the group.
Lady might be stretching it a bit. Girl for a start. And the way she was poured into her jeans and threatening to burst out of her blouse suggested anything but lady.
Gan felt old, not for the first time.
Recently it was happening more often as she realised how out of fashion and out of touch she was becoming. She didn't really know why she had said ladies first. As a rule, she didn't think women deserved any special favours. She had only ever sought equality for herself, not preferential treatment. A deeply tanned man of about 50 with a goatee beard and a receding hairline of wispy fair hair, dressed rather as de Beck, had been in the businessman's uniform of suit and tie, stood up. The light glinted off his blue-tinted spectacles, momentarily hiding his eyes. Gan thought his skin looked leathery, but he didn't have the appearance of a man used to working outside.
Look, we've all been held up. I had an important meeting this morning in Belfast. I want to cooperate with the police, of course I do, but I need to get to my meeting.
It was on the tip of Gan's tongue to tell him to sit down and wait when the female passenger spoke up.
I'm only here because of Dave, my boyfriend.
She inclined her head towards the youngest of the three men and flashed him a smile.
I wasn't anywhere near your dead man. I don't mind waiting.
Thank you, miss.
Gan waited for an answer.
Robson. Mandy Robson.
Miss Robson, thank you. I'll speak to you first then, sir.
She turned to the belligerent little man. Shall we go over here? Gan realised that although she was thinking of him as a little man, in fact he was not that much shorter than she was. Rather, it was more to do with the way he held his body, his shoulders hunched up, his stooped stance with his stomach overflowing the waistband of his trousers, and his agitated demeanour that made him seem smaller. She led the way to a table, set well away from everyone else. Harris joined her, and the two sat down on one side, facing the passenger. It was Harris who started the questioning. He already had his notebook at the ready.
Name, please. Paul Van Hooven. They've already asked me that.
Annoyance sounded in his answer.
May we see your passport, please, Mr. Van Hooven? Gan asked and held out her hand.
Her eyes displayed some surprise when he handed her a green passport, which she immediately recognised as South African. The leathery skin made sense to her now. The hot African sun, of course. She scanned the pages, then handed the document to Harris so he could record the man's details.
And what brings you to Northern Ireland, sir?
I have a meeting at the university. My company sponsors certain research activities and I visit twice a year for updates.
So it's not your first time here then, sir? Harris inquired, handing the passport back to its owner.
No, not at all. I've been here 4 or 5 times.
His impatience to get away was clear. Understandable if he was missing his meeting, but not endearing when a man had lost his life.
You don't have a South African accent.
It was a statement, but really a question Gan was posing.
I'm not a South African citizen, but I was born in the Netherlands and still have family there. That's why I was flying from Amsterdam. I'd been visiting my brother and his wife for a few days, but I've lived all over the world, so I don't have much of an accent, I guess. Look, is all this really relevant? I was sitting behind your dead man, and I wasn't even directly behind him. I didn't speak to him. I didn't see anything. I can't tell you anything.
He seemed very definite, and until they were sure they had a crime to investigate, Gawn didn't want to push too hard.
"Are you staying in Belfast, sir?" she asked. "I'll be here until Thursday. If you need to contact me, I'm staying at the Europa Hotel."
"Yes, we know where that is." Van Hooven stood up and so did Gawn. She seemed to tower over him.
"Thank you."
They shook hands. Her immediate impression was of flabby hands that had never done any manual work. Pen pusher's hands, as her father had called them. As Harris escorted Van Hooven to the door, Gawn turned her attention to the other two men. She decided to leave Smith until last. He had been beside De Beck. He was the one who was most likely to be able to provide some information to help them work out what had happened. When Harris returned, she sent him to bring the other witness across.
"This is Bill Andrews, ma'am."
Andrews was a ruddy-faced man with dark, wavy hair, which was just showing its first signs of greying at the temples. He had the look of someone used to spending his time outdoors. Dressed today in a suit, he looked uncomfortable in it, and his tie was loosened at the neck as if it had been choking him, and perhaps it had been. His neck was huge. It immediately made her think of the Russian weightlifters she had seen at the Olympics on television. He dragged a small overnight bag on wheels behind him, and draped over it was a heavy gabardine coat from which he had extracted the bag of sweets earlier. His expression was friendly but nervous, which could just be an indication that he was not used to dealing with the police.
"Mr. Andrews, I'm DC Girvin. Thank you for waiting."
"Didn't think I had any choice."
It was said more in good humour than anger. He was not being aggressive.
"Poor man, dying like that, doesn't bear thinking about."
He seemed genuinely upset. Perhaps it had something to do with being approximately the same age as the deceased.
"I see from the passenger list you're British."
"Yes, born and bred in County Down. I live outside Banbridge."
"And you were in the Netherlands for?"
She left the sentence hanging for him to finish.
"Business. I'm a farmer. I was visiting a farm there and looking at some cattle."
"What can you tell us about Mr. De Beck?"
"Is that his name? I only passed the time of day with him when we first got on the plane. He was already in his seat. I was getting myself comfortable behind him. I leant on the back of his seat to get past my neighbour. There's not a lot of room in these wee planes for a man my size, you know."
He patted his stomach.
"I excused myself and tried to make a bit of conversation about the weather and the flight. Something about hoping it wouldn't be too bumpy with the wind. But he didn't really answer me back. He seemed to be half asleep. He just nodded at me. And that's it, really. I didn't speak to him again."
Gawn thought the farmer a little garrulous. She didn't think he could add too much to their knowledge of what had led to the man's death, if indeed anything other than high cholesterol or a dicky heart had caused it. She was becoming more sure they were wasting their time.
"Thank you, Mr. Andrews. Leave your contact details with my sergeant just in case we need to get in touch."
Once again, they shook hands and Harris escorted him out. Just David Smith left to talk to, and his girlfriend, of course. It wasn't looking like there would be much of a case to investigate. The poor man had just died, probably of a heart attack. Without being asked to, Harris brought both the lanky young man, who had been seated beside De Beck, and his girlfriend across to her. He pulled up an extra chair for the girl. When they were all seated, and Smith had stowed his heavy backpack under the table, Gawn began to question the Australian, as she saw from his passport.
"Mr. Smith, what, if anything, can you tell me about Mr. De Beck?"
She sat back in her chair, not really expecting that he would have too much to add to their meagre information.
"He was already in his seat when we got there."
He glanced across nervously at the girl to include her in his response, and she nodded in agreement. Gawn noticed his habit of pulling his sleeves down over his hands so that they were ripped to the cuffs and only the tips of his fingers peeked out from the sweatshirt material. "It was a real bummer.
We hadn't been able to book seats together, and we hoped that whoever was in that seat would swap with Mandy. But he was already out of it when I tried to ask him. Then the guy beside Mandy wouldn't swap either, and the cabin crew wouldn't let us move to another row, although there were plenty of empty seats. We spent most of the flight talking across the aisle, so I had my back to him most of the time.
What do you mean he was out of it? Gan jumped on the comment.
He was asleep when you first saw him.
Harris spoke at almost the same time. He glanced across, fearful that she would be annoyed at his interjection.
Yes, sort of. Not 100% maybe, but he wasn't going to talk to me anyway.
Did you speak to him again at any time during the flight, sir?
Smith smiled across at his girlfriend.
I was otherwise engaged most of the time, if you know what I mean.
He looked directly at Harris, not quite with a wink, but near to it.
You did speak to him once, Dave, remember? You said he sort of moaned or something.
Oh yeah, that's right. Maybe about 10 minutes before we landed, and I wanted to put something away into my bag in the overhead locker, and I knocked against him when I was reaching up. I said sorry, but he only kind of moaned at me. I noticed that he seemed to be sweating a lot and drooling. It was hot, so I didn't think too much about it, and like old guys like that do sweat and drool, don't they?
Both Harris and Gan wondered what age Smith would regard as old. To anyone his age, 22 according to his passport, anything over 50 would be ancient.
And there's nothing else you noticed?
She looked closely at the Australian as he shook his head.
Well, we may need to speak to you again, Mr. Smith. How long are you staying in Northern Ireland?
It was Mandy Robson who replied to Gann's question.
We'll be here for at least 3 months. Dave's going to meet my family and see a bit of the country.
Her accent was Derry, moderated by Melbourne, Gann reckoned.
Thank you for your help, both of you. Leave your contact details with the sergeant here. Enjoy your stay.
While Harris walked them out, Maxwell walked across to his former boss.
Anything useful, ma'am?
No, Joy. Unless you count the fact that the man was asleep and was sweating, which might suggest he was ill. But we don't have anything definite and won't until Dr. Norris is finished. It's probably all been a total waste of our time. Just down to our newbie pathologist being overly careful. But it was good to see you, Paul.
She smiled broadly at him.
You too, ma'am.
He watched her walk away with her new sergeant following in her wake. He couldn't help thinking how Kerry had said he followed Gan like a puppy. It wasn't true, but for 10 seconds, he allowed himself to remember when that would have been him. He loved his new job, and Kerry loved the extra money, which is allowing them to move house and the fact that his hours were more predictable, but he couldn't totally ignore a little pang of regret not to be in the thick of investigations again alongside Gan.
Chapter 5. The last time Gan had visited the regional forensic mortuary, it had been to question the state pathologist as a suspect in her serial killer investigation. She could remember the nerves in her stomach that day, the enormity of what was happening, and how it could mean the end of his career, or hers, even if he wasn't guilty. Today was very different. Harris was by her side this time, not Maxwell. She considered Maxwell's suggestion that she go easy on the new man and give him a chance. He should have known her well enough to realise that wasn't her way. Harris needed to understand what she expected of him. And if he didn't measure up, he needed to know that too. It wouldn't be doing him any favours to let him get used to being sloppy. As they approached the examination room, they were surprised to hear music. Gan immediately recognised it. Billy Joel belting out, "We Didn't Start the Fire." They suited up before entering the room. The music increased in volume when they opened the door. Dr. Norris seemed to have already started, even though they were on time, one of Gan's character quirks. She hated being late for anything.
Dressed in a long green gown and white boots, the pathologist was standing back to the door over the body, which was partially covered and lying on a cold steel slab, the middle of three in the room. The others were empty. Bright light flooded down onto the body. The pathologist hadn't heard them coming in over the noise of the music and only became aware of their presence when they entered her peripheral vision. She immediately switched the music off, looking guilty.
Sorry, I didn't know what the protocol is here, but I always had music when I worked in Boston. The medical examiner didn't mind, but I guess Dr. Monroe might. But he's not here.
She smiled conspiratorially as she added the last phrase. How the pathologist chose to do her work didn't really concern Gawn, although she expected Monroe would have apoplexy when he found out. All she was worried about was that the work was accurate and preferably speedy.
I didn't think we were late.
You aren't. I started a bit early. I undressed Mr. DeBeck and bagged his clothing for your forensics people. I'm just about to start the external examination now. I waited for you. You'll be pleased to know I kill the music at this point, so I can record my findings. Judges don't tend to like a rock and roll background when they listen to my evidence. She smiled at them. Gawn remembered Maxwell always complaining that the mortuary staff had a weird sense of humor. She had never thought they had any sense of humor at all, but this one seemed like a lively sort. She would certainly bring some fresh thinking to the job. She speculated how Norris would get on with Monroe when he got back from his sabbatical and guessed there might be fireworks ahead.
"And I was right," she continued. "There's some indication of a mark on the upper right arm corresponding to the mark in his jacket. Not a knife. Too fine for that, even for a stiletto. Probably a syringe. I could have missed it if I hadn't noticed his jacket."
"You mean he was a junkie?" asked Harris.
"You guys must have really funny junkies here if they shoot up through their jackets."
Harris blushed and Gawn interrupted, displeased with the doctor's sarcasm towards her officer.
"If not a junkie, what are you suggesting, doctor?"
And she thought of the woman's comment from yesterday about not speculating.
"He may have been injected with something recently, but obviously not at your local doctor's surgery when it was through his coat. We'll have to wait for the tox report to know exactly what was injected. And even then, depending on what it was and how long ago it happened, there may not be any traces left in the body."
The doctor sounded disappointed. Perhaps she was bored already with her move from Boston to much more parochial Belfast and was seeing mysteries where there were none.
"When I'm sending his clothing to forensics," she added, "there's a chance there may be some residue of whatever it was on his sleeve."
Gawn wondered how Monroe and McDowell, her boss, would feel about financing speculative tests like this. She suspected it would never have happened if Monroe had been here, though she liked to think he would have picked up on the mark on DeBeck's arm. But she wasn't sure. She was beginning to think Norris was the kind of pathologist she could work with. Dr. Norris pulled back the covering on the body, fully revealing the corpse. Gawn was aware of a slight movement to her right. She glanced quickly across at Harris, but he seemed okay. Meanwhile, Norris had been hunched over the body. She called on her assistant to help her turn the corpse over and then on his back again before she spoke. "Other than that, the body is of a well-nourished 55-year-old man. There are no distinguishing marks and no indication of any other external trauma. Inspector Maxwell was quick off the mark and got me DeBeck's details from the Netherlands. He hadn't seen a doctor in the last 6 months and there was no indication of heart problems or high blood pressure or anything like that in his medical history or his family history either. He seemed to have been remarkably healthy until he wasn't. However, at his age, if he had a stressful job, it could have crept up in him or come out of the blue, but an examination of the heart and brain will tell us that. Our answers all lie inside the body." Gawn was pleased to hear about Maxwell's good work.
She had been sure he would do well and wouldn't be surprised to see him make chief inspector before very long. Maybe someday she would be answering to him. Dr. Norris turned and addressed the two detectives. There are no other external marks on the body, but with even just a quick look, I've seen some damage on the rectal area. I'll need to examine the rectum and bowel more closely to know what might have caused it.
You think he was gay, doctor? Harris asked.
How would I know what his sexual proclivities were? Came the sharp reply. Gunn was still enjoying the thought that Maxwell's career move seemed to be working out well for him when she noticed that Harris was beginning to look slightly green. His voice, when he had been speaking to the doctor, was slightly higher pitched than usual, and now she watched as his eyes scanned the room, trying to focus but avoiding to take in the equipment sitting ready for use. The saw, the electric drill, the metal dishes, the specimen jars. The pathologist was poised with her scalpel over the chest cavity, ready to make the Y incision to give her access to the internal organs. Gunn didn't relish the prospect of having to try to catch her sergeant if he fainted, or worse, still accompany him to A&E if he injured himself. I think we leave you to it then, doctor. If anything shows up in the body, let me know. Otherwise, we'll wait until we have all the test results back. Gunn turned as she spoke, signalling Harris to follow her, which he seemed only too glad to do. Once outside in the fresh air, the sergeant stood still, hands on hips, bent slightly forward, and took several deep breaths. He looked abashed. A normal colour was beginning to return to his face. Gunn had walked ahead to her car, ignoring him, and was sitting inside waiting, engine running. He ran across and jumped in beside her.
Sorry, ma'am.
She looked across at him. Her expression was not unkind.
First time.
He didn't speak, just nodded. It happens to the best of us. Next time you'll be better prepared. It had never happened to her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.